Now I'd like to introduce our guest tonight on Sports Connection from his home in New Kensington, PA, Mr. Willie Thrower, who played at Kent High School back in 1949. He graduated from there where he was an outstanding single-wing tailback, led Kent High as they dominated WPIL back in the late 40s. There he went along with six other members of his high school team at Kent High to Michigan State, where he led 1949-52 there, and of course they won the national championship back in 1952. Then as a free agent, he signed with the Chicago Bears of the NFL, where he also was a trendsetter, and back on October 18, 1953, in Wrigley Field in Chicago, Willie Thrower from New Kensington, PA, became the first black in professional football. Mr. Thrower, welcome to the Sports Connection.
Fine, doing good.
Okay, as I was saying earlier, prior to putting you on the air tonight, you broke the color barrier back on October 18th, 1953 at Wrigley Field in Chicago. Can you tell us what you recall from that historic day?
The first game that I played in?
Yes.
Well, I was very, very enthused, very happy to get in the ball game. In fact, I was surprised to get in at that time. We were losing. It was a very close game, but we were losing like by two touchdowns at the time. The final score was 35-28. And George Hallis had been a little teed off at George Blanda because he had been throwing a few interceptions.
Okay.
He had been taking them down the field in good shape, but once he get within the 20 or the 25-yard line, he would throw an interception. So I was answering the phone, you know, up to the press box, and he was pretty mad. So finally he just said, Willie, he said, warm up. So I warmed up, and about 5 minutes later I went in.
Okay, and of course you had a pretty fair day considering it was your first time in the National Football League. I think it was something 8 out of 27, was that it?
No, I completed 3 out of 8.
3 out of 8, okay.
But the time I went in with the ball on our 35-yard line.
Okay.
And I took them all the way down to the 4-yard line.
So very impressive drive.
Right, and what happened was it was a close game at the time that I had went in. And he took me out at the 4-yard line.
Now, why in the world did he do that?
I was a little mad, and the fans were a little mad because he took me out. Well, like I said, it was a close game, and he figured George Blanda had more experience than I had at the time.
Well.
So we went in, he took him in for a touchdown, and that tied the score up. And they came back and made another touchdown, beat us 35-28.
Sounds to me, Mr. Thurl, like you did most of the work and Blanda got the glory on that particular situation.
On that particular day. Well, see, most of the fans there had seen me play or heard of me playing at Michigan State because most of the players that was on a Michigan State team was from the Chicago area.
Okay.
So most of the fans was a little mad because he took me out. And the game was just about over at the time that he put me in. So we finally ended up to score 35-28.
When you became a member of the Bears, I said you were a free agent and you selected the Chicago Bears. What was it like when you walked into your first NFL training camp? How were you treated?
Well, I was treated very nice. Let me say this. Before I went to the Bears, you know, at the time, whites couldn't play against blacks. Blacks couldn't play against whites in southern schools.
Mm-hmm.
That didn't come into prominence until 1957. It's SMU, when SMU took the first black. But to let you know what went on was the linemen at the Bears, they had never played with any blacks.
Okay.
Most of the linemen were from southern schools, and they hadn't played against any blacks at that time. But by George Hallis being a strong coach and so forth, there wasn't too much racism or prejudice there at the time because George was a very strong coach and a very strong person, and he wouldn't allow any of that to go on.
Did you notice anything in the locker room? Did the guys have that camaraderie, that spirit of togetherness, or were things kind of like separated in the locker room?
No. There was nothing that was separated.
Okay.
I mean, it was all team effort. I mean, we had four blacks besides me on the team, but there was no prejudice in no way there.
Somewhere, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I had interviews with different people before. They seemed to think that there was a lot of prejudice there when I was there, which there wasn't. You would think it would by me being the first black quarterback, but there wasn't because of George. I think George kept most of that down.
So the general or the coach, the famous George Harris, was pretty much the guy that kept things on an even keel. Somewhere between your debut, it wasn't until really 1969 when James Harris became the first black first-string quarterback with the Buff Bills that the perception existed that being black and a first-string quarterback...
Well, I don't think he was the first. I think Marlon Briscoe was.
Okay. Well, Marlon Briscoe appeared in an NFL game 13 years...
after me.
After you.
Yeah.
Right. And then in 1969, James Harris of Buffalo became a regular full-time quarterback.
Well, Marlon Briscoe was full-time, too.
Oh, he was?
But Harris was the full-time in the NFL.
Okay.
Marlon Briscoe was the first full-time black quarterback in the AFC.
What was your, or what is your opinion, Mr. Thrower, as to why we didn't see a pro football owners were hesitant to start blacks at quarterback in the National Football League for such a long period of time?
Between me and Marlon Briscoe?
Yeah.
Well, my conception would be that it really wasn't ready for a black to step in right after me, because for one thing, they weren't playing them in high school, black athletes. They weren't playing them in high school. They weren't playing them in college. And that's the reason why it took so long, as far as I'm concerned, because you have to start off in high school.
Okay.
They didn't have the idea that a black could lead in high school. So quite naturally, they didn't have the same idea in college.
And of course, now we have Randall Cunningham starting in Philadelphia,
yeah.
Warren Moon in Houston, of course, Doug Williams on the Super Bowl champion Washington Redskins. You ever get the feeling that maybe you were born about 15 or so years too soon?
Oh, definitely.
Okay.
Definitely.
Because it seems
now,
like...
There's a lot of black quarterbacks now in the college ranks.
Oh, yeah. No doubt. Don McPherson, you were talking about from Syracuse,
right.
Of course.
Don McPherson is about the only one that I know of that's a real drop-back quarterback. See, most of the colleges in the South and in the North now, they got black quarterbacks, but they're using them from a split tee.
Or wishbone or something like that.
See, because of their agility and quickness of foot.
Okay.
Now, it's going to be hard for quite a few of them to hit the pros, because the pros don't have time to take a year and a half or 2 years to break you from a wishbone to a drop-back quarterback. That's the way I look at it right now. I don't think you'll see too many right quick.
Okay.
But there's an opening now.
I think it is, and I think the opportunity is
there's
there.
Definitely an opening. I think McPherson should come in there on his own.
And do a good job.
See, but once the black quarterbacks start going to schools like San Jose State, Brigham Young, and those different dropback schools, then they'll be recognized a little more.
So you think,
a little quicker for the pro ranks.
So you're thinking it's the best thing is to go to where there's a pro offense in place in college if you want to make it as
right.
a quarterback in that football.
Especially in a dropback situation.
Okay.
A school where they have dropback quarterback instead of split tee and running along the line, wishbone. You know, you can't make it in the pros running those kind of offenses.
Okay. Hold on a second, Mr. We got a caller. Mark, you're on the Sports Connection. Welcome to the show with Mr. Willie Thrower.
Hello, I'd like to try a trivia.
Okay. What question would you want to take a shot at?
The scholarship one.
Okay.
I guess it's Iowa.
All right. The question is, what school led the NCAA Division I in rebounding margin last season? And your guess is?
Iowa.
That is correct. How'd you figure that one out?
We had a book that had, like, stats and stuff like that.
So you went to the smart book, Mark.
Yeah.
Okay, well, that is, we got a question for Mr. Thrower.
Yeah, I was wondering, who were some of his idols when he was growing up that made him want to be a quarterback?
Mr. Thrower?
Yes.
Did you get that? The question was, who were some of your idols when you were growing up to be a quarterback?
My idol was Sammy Ball.
Sammy Ball? Okay, you want
to... Yeah, probably whoever asked that question probably don't remember Sammy Ball unless he's a little older. But that was my idol, Sammy Ball from Washington Redskins.
Okay.
To me, he was one of the greatest dropback quarterbacks. And I read a lot about Sammy Ball, and I tried to imitate him.
All righty. Mark, anything else for Mr. Thrower?
How much pressure does he think, like, the first black football coach will be under, you know, as compared to he was as being the first black quarterback?
Okay. Mr. Thrower, did you catch that?
No, I can't hear it too good.
Okay, the question is, what do you think the pressure will be like on the first black pro football coach?
I think it'd be quite a bit of pressure right off the bat, but if he's qualified... And if he has good coaching staff, I think he should make it good.
Okay.
But it'll be tough, you know, getting the confidence and so forth.
And getting
but like
in,
I say, if he's got a good coaching staff and he's a good organizer, he should do good.
And I think Mr. Thurl being in a good situation, too, as far as the ownership and the commitment to winning.
Right.
You just can't...
Yeah, you have to have that, too.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have all that.
Okay. Mark, anything else? Okay, thanks for calling. If you hang on, our producer there will get your name and everything, and you can go down and pick up your Subway Shop goodies for answering that question correct. Thanks for calling the Sports Connection. Okay, Mark, 732-2888 is the number. A couple good questions there for Mr. Thrower. While we're waiting for the next call to come, Mr. Thrower, let's talk a little bit about your high school days. I talked to you about this earlier. You played at New Kensington High School.
Right.
Ken High, as it was known back in those days, when it dominated the WPIL in the
right.
40s. You were that single-wing tailback, but you did all the passing from for that running team. And you played a game against Ambridge High School one year
right.
that we were talking about, in which you came out of it, you know, both eyes swollen and beaten almost to a pulp, and you upset them. Tell
almost
us a little bit about
dead.
That game. Yeah, tell us a little bit about that game.
Okay. All right, well, where the rivalry all started was Ambridge came down to New Kensington the year before we played the game at Ambridge. They had came down the year before with supposedly the best high school football team in the history of Ambridge. They had guys like Sam Bombiani, Giona, a real good backfield, Bo Zeke, and they were bragging about how they were going to beat us because we had won the WPIL the year before.
Mm-hmm.
So they came down to our stadium, and they was bragging about what they were going to do to us, and we turned the tables on them, and we beat them 26-6. So they were really upset. Mo Rubenstein was the coach, and they were really upset about that loss because it knocked them out of the WPIL playoff. So even before the next season started, they had put out the word that they were waiting for us to come up here and play them. So when we went into the stadium with the bus and so forth, they had big signs out there to that effect that they were going to do a job on us, which they really did. So what happened was the coaching staff up there let the referees get the game out of hand, and they permitted them to play dirty against the New Kensington High School team, and they broke one of our players' jaws, Kosikowski, Rinaldo Kosikowski. They broke his jaw. Dick Tambur, our center and linebacker, they broke his leg, compound fracture. And our quarterback, Cubby France, Bob Giona, and Harris, the two tackles, they picked him up and threw him down on his head first. And they did a job on us. And me, my face looked like a butcher had chopped me up.
Huh.
The thing is, every time I carried the ball, they were hitting me in the face any way they could, whether I hit the ball or not. And I complained to the referees and so forth, but to no avail, they didn't do anything. So my coach walked out on the field, Don Fletcher, God bless him, he's dead now. But he walked out on the field, he called all the referees and everyone together, He said, look, if any more of this type of ball playing goes on, he said, I'm taking my team off the field. And which all of us knew that he would do it, so we pulled him off to the side, the coach, and told our coach, say, look, we're going to win this game regardless of the type of play that they're having here. We're going to win the game. And just forget about it and let us go ahead and play the game. We're going to play it anyway. And we ended up, I think the score was 26-23 or something in that area. Anyway, it was like 3 or 4 points. But the thing is, they had just scored a touchdown with a minute and a half left to play, which could have sealed the game. But instead, they kicked off to us, and four guys still came down and hit me. And we had a little quick halfback named Joe Giordano. He took the ball up the middle, hit to the right sideline, and was off to the races. That's the only way we'd have beat them. If they'd have played a regular game, we couldn't have beat them.
Mm-hmm.
That's how good they were.
So
we beat them because they still sent four guys after me, and which left the middle open and the sideline open, and Joe Giordano ran for a touchdown to beat them.
And that was a big win.
That was the win that took us to the WPL, our second championship.
But wasn't some rule made as far as Ambridge and Ken I playing anymore after that game?
No, after that game, New Kensington High School made a proclamation that there will never be another athletic event between Ambridge and New Kensington High School. The only way would have to be another game or another, it would be a playoff game.
Okay.
So that proclamation is still in the school office.
Okay. Now you went on to Michigan State, where you were up there battling a couple of guys by the name of Duro and Yusick, who was from Conemaugh, Pennsylvania.
Right.
You felt you were a better passer than those two guys. What happened up there?
Oh, I was definitely a better passer. Like I say, I was the first black quarterback in the Big Ten. And my coach, Biggie Munn, which is dead now, and Duffy Doherty, both of them, they took me there, but with the idea that they were going to use a split T with me on a halfback. But instead, when they got there, they junked that offense and put the regular T formation in, which put me on the sideline. I played behind Al Doro. I played behind Yusick. And either one of them couldn't pass like me, so forth. But they were there. I never cried about it because I had a very good education, and I enjoyed Michigan State every minute of it.
So you're a proud Spartan alumnus.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Of course, you had to be happy with the Rose Bowl win this year against USC, led by Lorenzo White.
What was that again?
The victory in the Rose Bowl, Lorenzo White, Michigan State.
Oh, yeah, that was nice. I wish I could have been there, but it was a little too far away.
Oh, I can imagine. Shining moment you had, Mr. Thrower, back during the championship season against Notre Dame. You came off the bench to pull out a big win. Tell us a little bit about that. It was a nasty televised game.
That was my only really big game. Well, I played a lot of football at Michigan State, but that was the one game that I played the most in. I went in at the beginning of the second half, and we were losing 7-0 whenever I went in. And I went in and threw one touchdown pass, and I took him down. And my hometown buddy, Vince Pisano, took the ball over for a touchdown. We won 21-7.
They say the fans were screaming, "We want Willie, we want Willie."
Yes, there was 50,000 people in there screaming, "We want Willie." And that was the year that my coach had came up to see the ball game. So I was sitting on the bench, and I saw him come down from the stands. I saw him call Biggie Munn over to the sideline. Well, no, Biggie was the head coach, but he called Duffy Doherty over to the sideline, and he said something to Duffy Doherty. I don't know what he said to him today, but anyway, about 4 or 5 minutes later, he told me to warm up. Duffy told me to warm up.
And you went in and did it.
I went on in. Probably I wouldn't have went in then if it don't be for my high school coach coming down off the sideline.
So you know what? They kind of refused to even play you, even in that situation.
Well, that's the way it was. It was a little tough being a black quarterback even in college.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Thrower, we're going to take a break, so hang in there with us, would you please?
Yes, I will.
Okay, we're going to take a break. We'll come back. We're visiting with Mr. Willie Thrower, who was the first black quarterback in professional football, as well as the first black quarterback in Big Ten football. And if you got a question for him, the number is 732-2888. If you want to take a shot at one of our trivia questions and talk with Mr. Thrower, do the same. We'll be back on the Sports Connection.
Just sitting around, for this brief time have nothing to do. Well, just put your gym shoes on and come over to the McCallumfield House for a little relaxation and excitement. Edinburgh Athletics has so much to offer, like an Olympic-sized swimming pool, a nicely heated gym equipped with a newly surfaced floor, and six basketball rims for your enjoyment, two newly done racquetball courts, and a brand new weight room, and plenty of other things for you to enjoy. So come over to McComb, relax, enjoy, and sign up to have a little fun.
Hello, I'm Hal Umbarger, Assistant to the Director of Athletics here at Edinburgh University. I want to tell everyone that we have some really great recreational facilities here on the university campus. Some of our more popular activities are racquetball, swimming, and weightlifting. Also available is the intramural sports program, the judo club, and a brand new all-weather track. So get out and enjoy some of the fine recreational facilities available to you, the students of Edinburgh University, free of charge. The opportunity for recreation and exercise are numerous at Edinburgh, and all the students are encouraged to participate.
Edinburgh. Oh, I'm getting... Hello, this is TR, the thin one from WMMS in Cleveland, the Mighty Buzzard. Congratulations, Edinburgh University, on a happy 10th anniversary for serving the tri-state area. You, being a discriminating person, are, of course, listening to WFSE 88.9. Way to go.
Okay, we're back on the Sports Connection, and before we go back with Mr. Thrower, a couple of other sports items I want to make you aware of. In NHL tonight after one period, the Winnipeg Jets 2, the Quebec Nordiques 2. In NBA action tonight after one quarter, Indiana 32, the New York Knicks 19. And after one, the Sacramento Kings 29, the Atlanta Hawks 21. The Hawks lost a tough one to Chicago yesterday on George Washington's birthday. College basketball, the Seton Hall Pirates 45, St. Peter's 24. That's at halftime. Of course, Seton Hall, a member of the Big East Conference. We mentioned the Olympics earlier. Tonight, the gold medals up for grabs this evening in pairs figure skating. American hopes rest with the duo of Peter Opergaard and Jill Watson, who enter the long program finale in third place after Sunday's short program behind a couple of Soviet teams used the championships. And I tell you what, it's going to be hard for them to move up and win the gold tonight, but it would be nice to see them win a medal in the Olympics tonight in the pairs figure skating. And in hockey today, Poland, of all teams, a surprising one-all tie with the pre-tournament favorite Sweden today as they stopped the goaltender Andres Hennes, stopped all but one of 32 Swedish shots in a defensive-minded, hard-hitting game today up in Calgary. All right, so we got another caller on the line. Ron, you're on the Sports Connection. Go right ahead.
How you doing, John?
I'm doing pretty good. You got a question for Mr. Thrower tonight?
Yes, and I'd like to congratulate Mr. Thrower on paving the way for black quarterbacks in the NFL.
Okay, I'm sure, Mr. Thrower, you appreciate that.
I'd like to ask him, does he think that Mr. McPherson, the quarterback for Syracuse, do you think he has a chance in the NFL being a black quarterback and, you know, being that he's so agile and is a good runner, do you think he has a chance in the NFL as a quarterback?
Mr. Thrower, the question there from our callers is that what do you think McPherson's chances of making it are in the NFL? You mentioned it earlier, but maybe you can summarize quickly what do you think Don McPherson will be able to do in the National Football League?
Well, looking at Don for the last 2 years, at least he doesn't throw that hard.
Mm-hmm.
I think his chances are fair. I don't think they're great.
Okay, another thing the gentleman wanted to pass along his story. He said he wants to thank you for paving the way for black quarterbacks in pro football.
Yeah.
I don't know if you heard that, but he wanted to thank you. Anything else for Mr. Thrower, Ron?
No, that's it, John. Just, you know, like I said, I like to thank him, you know, and, you know, you've been having a good show. That's about it.
Okay, thanks a lot for calling, Ron. All right, 732-2888 is the number to get in on the sports conversation tonight. We're talking with the first black quarterback in the National Football League, Mr. Willie Thrower, who now lives in New Kensington, PA, which is his hometown. He was an outstanding high school athlete there, going on to Michigan State, and of course then with the Chicago Bears in NFL. I know there's something else you're proud of, Mr. Thrower, and you can say that you are a member of three Hall of Fames. Not too many people can say that.
Yes, I am.
Okay.
I'm a member of Westmoreland County Hall of Fame, which New Kensington is in Westmoreland County.
Okay.
And also Allegheny-Kiskey, which takes care of the Pittsburgh and the Upper Valley, which we call Freeport, Vandegrift, and Apollo Ridge and places like that.
Okay.
And then I'm in Hall of Fame in Canton, Ohio.
That's the big one.
That's the big one. I wasn't elected there by sports writers or newscasters. I was there because they have a black section there on the second floor for black athletes or black personnel like Robinson, me, and Deacon Dan Tyler and Tank Younger and guys like that. There's about 15 or 16. It's similar to the Hall of Fame in Cooperstown, where guys like Satchel Paige and his buddy
Cool Papa Bell and people like
didn't get a chance to play in the baseball league before, you know, they opened the gates.
Okay, well, no doubt about that. That's a distinction not many people have,
right,
being members of three Hall of Fames.
Yeah, I'm proud of it.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about the football today. You look at college football and you see, like you mentioned earlier, teams in the South that for years, you know, did not play blacks in any position, let alone quarterback position. And
right,
now you look at the Alabamas and you look at some of the Tennessees and you see those playing prominent roles. It seems like we have come almost full circle, I would say, as far as blacks being allowed to participate now at the collegiate level, at least.
Right.
Okay, we're going to take another break, Mr. Thrower, and when we come back, we will talk a little bit more with you, get your thoughts on some things,
okay,
and we'll pause for this brief timeout.
Right.
Hello, my name is Bernie Twardowski. I'm the Director of Student Development with a few words about the Student Development Office. Many services are provided by the office, such as the wellness programs, recreation and intramural programs, Tuesday night series, peer counseling, and many more. If you have any questions concerning the quality of your life on this campus or activities and functions available to you as an Edinburgh student, please contact the Student Development Office at 2768 or visit us in person at the University Center.
Hi, I'm Joe Tate of the Cleveland Cavaliers, and you can catch all the exciting action of Fighting Scott basketball with the voice of the Scots, Mark Tromba, right here. So tune in to your season ticket to Fighting Scott basketball, 88.9 WFSE, celebrating 10 years of radio excellence.
This is Doug Hawks from KDKA Radio. Happy 10th anniversary, WFSE, FM 88.9.
Okay, we're back on the Sports Connection, and we're visiting with Mr. Willie Thrower, and we're talking about being the first black quarterback in the NFL. Mr. Thrower, you played briefly with the Chicago Bears, and then you went up to Canada, played a couple of years there before returning to New Kensington. What was your Canadian experience like?
Well, I played up at Winnipeg after I got finished playing with the Chicago Bears. See, the reason why I left Chicago Bears was they had Zeke Borkowski coming out of the University of Georgia.
Okay.
They had just signed him for a fabulous contract, bonus contract, for $75,000, which was unheard of at that time.
Mm.
And then they had Ed Brown coming out of the service. And quite naturally, George Blanda was still there. So I went up Canada, up at the Winnipeg Blue Bombers. They had wanted me up there before Sid Luckman came down and signed me up with the Bears. So I went up there with them, and there was Bud Grant up there. He was our tight end. There was another quarterback up there that was the regular quarterback. That was Indian Jack Jacobs. He had a salary dispute with Green Bay Packers, and he had left Green Bay Packers the year before and went up to Green Bay.
Hmm.
So I played up up there behind behind Indian Jack Jacobs, and Bud Grant was our tight end.
Talented team up there.
Yeah, we played. I played a lot of ball. I played awful lot of ball up there between Calgary and Saskatchewan. And those, Seattle was. They call that the Big Four.
Mm-hmm.
The Big Four, the Western Provincial Big Four.
And you were a part of some successful teams up in Canada.
Yeah, this Saskatchewan, Calgary, Vancouver, Edmonton Eskimos.
Okay, you know what?
Winnipeg Blue Bombers.
You know what I find interesting today, Mr. Thrower, is that you see some National Football League quarterbacks with plays taped around their wrist out there playing. Was that a common practice in your day for the quarterbacks to have the plays taped around their wrist, or did you just go by memory?
Well, George Blender did have some taped on, but as a rule, he knew all the plays. But if the coaching staff put in some new plays, just for this team that they're playing, then they would put a little tape around their wrist, you know, and mark down certain plays that might be forgetful because we only practice it for a week.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, it was just put in 3 or 4 days before the game.
Okay.
To take care of one of their weaknesses. They've done that in a lot of colleges, too. In a lot of college games, like at Michigan State, our quarterbacks used to do that.
Okay. One final question for you, Mr. Thrower, and that is, if you were talking to a young black athlete today, high school age or whatever, about athletics and its importance in a person's life, what would you say to that young man?
Well, I would tell him sports is one of the greatest thing to build up character and to build up a person's personality. I would first tell him that if you can take the pressure of a sport, it's good for a young person.
Okay.
Especially if he's not all together. Mm-hmm. It'll build leadership and so forth.
And of course, I'm sure getting education is also something you would emphasize.
Yeah. Well, that's number one.
Okay. Well, Mr. It's
a character building. Any sport's a character building game.
Okay. Well, Mr. Thurr, I want to thank you very much for sharing some of your evening with us at home tonight, and hopefully sharing some of your experiences to the
right.
Folks out there, so they have a better understanding of what it was like just for 30-some years ago, which is not all that long. Look at the history of sports and things like that, and what you had to do.
Yeah.
But I bet you say it seemed like only yesterday to you sometimes, huh?
I wish it was.
Okay. Well, best of luck to you, Mr. Thrower,
yes,
and hopefully
sir.
I get a chance to talk with you again sometime.
Right. Thanks a lot.
Okay.
No.
Have a good night. You take care and say hello to your wife for me.
I sure will do.
All right.
Bye now.
Bye-bye.